Hello friends, I am Dr. Kamala Upadhyay. Today's lecture is on Tinea solium, which is an endoparasite from helminth. In this lecture, we will discuss about its structure, its life cycle, then the disease caused by Tinea solium, and finally its treatment. So let's start. So friends, Tinea solium belongs to class Gastroda of phylum Platyhelminthes, and which are commonly called as tapeworms for their long, flat and ribbon-like form, and they are basically endoparasite. The characteristic feature of phylum Platyhelminthes is that they are acoelomate triploblastic, bilaterally symmetrical, vermiform, dorsoventrally flattened and devoid of definite anus, without skeleton, respiratory and circulatory system. So this is the basic characteristic of phylum Platyhelminthes. And Gastroda, as I already told you, these are called as tapeworms because they are basically endoparasite. Then its class Eucastoda. In Eucastoda, those animals are included, or those worms are included, which body is long, ribbon-like, divided into scolex, neck and strobila with many proglottids like Tinea solium, okay, and larvae with six hooks. Then next, its systematic position is order Tineoidea. Tineoidea is also called as Cyclophyllidae, means those animals which having scolex with four large deep suckers and hooks, ovaries lobed, uterus blind, okay, so they are basically endoparasite. Then its genus is Tinea and species is Solium. So friends, if we see the habit and habitat of this animal, then we can find then that this animal lives in two hosts, means its life cycle is completed within two hosts. That's why the life cycle is digenetic. The man is the definitive host of this worm. Okay, so it live inside its alimentary canal with the help of its scolex. It anchored inside it. Then its secondary host is it may be pig, dog, sheep, goat, cattle, means all those animals which are domesticated or domestic animals. And if we see the distribution of this animal, then we find that wherever these domesticated animals are cultured or they are farmed, then it will also found in that places. That means the distribution is cosmopolitan in distribution of this animal. So friends, to understand its life cycle, you have to remember the structure of this animal first. So try to remember the structure with its labeling. So you can see the animal looks like a ribbon and body is divided into so many segments which are called as proglottids. The anterior most region of this animal, which is called as head. Okay, so this head region is very helpful to this animal to anchor the host intestine. Okay, so you can see the body is divided into three segments. First is head or scolex. Then next region, which is called as neck, which this neck is also called as area of proliferation. Means from where so many proglottids are formed. Then the next region, that is called as strobila, and it contains about 800 to 1000 segments or proglottids. So if we see the proglottids, these are of three types: immature proglottids, which are 200 in number, and they are the anterior most segments of this animal. Then mature proglottids, which having middle part of strobila with 450 proglottids, among which the anterior 100 to 150 proglottids contain only male reproductive organs, while the posterior 250 mature proglottids, they develop both male and female reproductive organs, making them hermaphrodite. Okay, so this is the main characteristic feature of this mature proglottids. Then the last the proglottid is ripe or gravid proglottids, means these are the posterior side of largest segments of the body, about 150 to 350 proglottids. The main characteristic feature of this ripe or gravid proglottid
is that they having only uterus with fertilized egg, and male and female reproductive organs are degenerated in these regions. Okay, so these gravid proglottids regularly detach from the posterior end of the strobila and pass out with the host feces. Okay, so shedding of gravid proglottids, it is also termed as apolysis. Now here you can see the structure of its scolex or head. It is the anterior most part of the animal and it looks like a knob. Okay, so there is two rows of hooks, and these hooks are 22 to 32 in number, and these are chitinous hooks. Okay, so next reason, it having four suckers with hooks and spines. It help the animal to sucking the food from the host intestine. Then it contain neck which having the area of proliferation for the formation of proglottids. So here is the structure of reproductive system in mature proglottid of Tinea sullium. You can see both male and female reproductive organs, they are found in same animal. That's why this animal is called as hermaphrodite animal. That's why self-fertilization as well as cross-fertilization occurred in this animal. So let's start with its male reproductive organ, which are written in red in color. So you can see the male reproductive organ, it contain testes, which are 350 to 600 in number, and these are small circular structures. These testes, they are connected to small ducts which are called as vasa efferentia. All these vasa efferentia, they all together collectively connected to a common duct which is called as vasa deferens. From this vasa deferens, it connected to a muscular structure which is called as serous. Then this serous is connected to a common gonopore through a genital atrium. So this is the structure of male reproductive organ. Its female reproductive part, it contain three lobes of ovary which are connected to each other with ovarian bridge, which is a common duct. Then this ovarian bridge is directly connected to a circular structure which is called as oocyte. This oocyte is surrounded by Mehli's gland. Mehli's gland secrete some secretions for to help the sperm to provide energy, and in the case of ova, it create a slippery environment so that the ova slip on it easily. Next, this oocyte is connected to directly with vitelline gland. This vitelline gland having so many follicular cells through a common duct which is called as vitelline duct. Okay, so there is a fertilization duct also between the vagina and the oocyte. This fertilization duct is the place where fertilization occurred. Then this fertilization duct is followed to a swollen structure which is called as seminal receptacle, where sperms are stored and they wait for the ova. Then this seminal receptacle towards the outside, it connected to vagina. Then vagina opens to outside through that common gonopore, which is for both male and female reproductive organs. Okay, so this is the whole structure of the Tinea sullium with its reproductive system. Then you can see the female reproductive system is connected to a common uterus, means the oocyte that is connected to uterus, where the fertilized eggs are stored. Okay, so it is the place where all the fertilized eggs are accommodated. That's why it becomes bulgy and branched in gravid proglottids. This is the structure of gravid proglottid, where you can see all the male and female reproductive parts are degenerated. Only the uterus is left, which having so many oncospheres or zygote. in 50,000 to 60,000 in number. Okay, so because of the accommodation of these eggs, it get branched. So this is the structure of gravid proglottid, which after detaching from the rest of the body, it goes into feces and goes outside from the host body. So friends, now we already understand so many things about the reproductive system of Taenia psyllium with the help of the figures. So now we know that tapeworm are hermaphrodite except one genus, Dioecocestus. Each mature proglottid contain a complete set of male and female reproductive organ, as we already seen, which develops from mesenchyme of this animal. Then male organs differentiated first before the differentiation of female organ. So after completion of fertilization and formation of eggs, the mature proglottids loses all its genital organs except a highly branched uterus filled with fertilized egg. Now the segments which having these fertilized eggs are called as ripe or gravid proglottid, as we already know now. So friends, let's revise the male reproductive system, which having testes. Testes are 350 to 600 in number, and these are numerous small spherical bodies scattered throughout the mesenchyme close to the dorsal surface. Then all these testes, they are connected with a fine ducts or branches which are called as vasa efferentia, and these vasa efferentia are the duct which are interconnected with each other testis, and all ducts finally unite and form a common sperm duct which is called as vasa deferens. Then this vasa deferens extend up to the lateral margin of proglottid and is a thick convoluted tubule or tube like structure. Then it is finally connected to a thick muscular copulatory organ which is called as serous. Then this serous connected to directly genital atrium, and this genital atrium finally opens to outside through a common gonopore. Okay, so gonopore is connected with sphincter muscle, means this sphincter muscle will act as a gate or door to open or shut this opening. So friends, let's revise the male reproductive organ with this picture. So it contains so many testes, means the number is 350 to 600. All these testes are connected to each other via small branches like structure which is called as vasa efferentia. All these vasa efferentia, they are all connected to a common duct, or they meet to a common duct which is called as vasa deferens. This vasa deferens follows to a muscular structure which is a copulatory organ of this animal which is called as serous. This serous is connected to genital atrium which is a cup-like structure. Then this genital atrium, it opens to outside through a common gonopore, and this gonopore also having a sphincter structure which help it to open and close it. So here is the female reproductive system. It having so many parts like ovary, then ovary is connected to oviduct, and then oviduct is followed to a circular structure which is called as ootype. Then this ootype is connected to a vitelline gland via a vitelline duct. Then there is a vagina. Vagina is connected to a swollen structure towards the oo-type, which is called a seminal receptacle. This seminal receptacle stores sperms and wait for ova. Then there is vitelline gland. This vitelline gland consists of numerous follicles secreting yolk cells. So this is the main characteristic feature of vitelline gland. It secretes yolk cells. Then there is a uterus. It's a cylindrical tube arises from oo-type, and it accommodates thousands of fertilized eggs, as a result of which it get branched. So in gravid proglottid, male and female reproductive organs have degenerated except the highly branched uterus, which I already seen. which is full of fertilized egg, and this number of these fertilized egg may ranges from 50,000 to 60,000 eggs. So friends, this segment is showing very easiest way to remember the female reproductive parts, which are ovary. Ovary is in three lobes. It is connected to oviduct. Then this oviduct leads to a circular structure which is called as ootype. This ootype is surrounded by Meles gland. Now this ootype having two branches. One of its branch or duct leads to uterus where 50,000 to 60,000 eggs can accommodate. Then another branch of this ootype or duct leads to vitelline gland from where numerous follicle secreting yolk cells are present. Then let's see the oviduct. Posteriorly, oviduct connected with fertilization duct where fertilization occurs. Then fertilization duct leads to a swollen structure which is called as seminal receptacle. This seminal receptacle stores so many sperms. Then seminal receptacle is directed to vagina. Then this tube-like structure vagina is leads to outside through a common gonopore. So friends, in this picture you can see all the female reproductive parts of the Tinea solium. So you can revise with this picture. Let's see the life cycle of Tinea solium. So as we all know now, Tinea solium life cycle is completed within two hosts. First or primitive host, that is man, and another or intermediate host is pig or other domestic animals. That's why the life cycle called as digenetic life cycle. And in its life cycle, there is no any free larval stages, and this life cycle starts with the copulation and fertilization, and fertilization will be either cross fertilization or self fertilization. So for fertilization process, the sperms are released into vagina of the same or other proglottid to release sperm. All these sperms, they are stored in seminal receptacle till ova are released by the ovary. Okay, so finally the fertilization occurred in fertilization duct and the zygote is formed. The next step is capsule formation, where the zygote or egg cells passed into oo-type and combined with large yolk cells or vitelline cells, which are formed by the vitelline gland. Okay, now these two enclosed in a cell or chorionic membrane, and the whole structure is called as capsule. This capsule is now goes to the uterus, where they accommodate. And due to the accommodation of large number of these capsules, the uterus become branched. So after the capsule formation, the next step is oncosphere formation. And this oncosphere formation, it followed by three steps, or it is completed by three stages. First one is cleavage, which start in the capsule. So the zygote undergo cleavage, and it starts when the egg cells is in uterus, and the cleavage is holoblastic and unequal. So after the cleavage, the zygote undergo the next stage, that is called as morula. Due to the unequal cleavage results in the formation of two kinds of cell. First one is megamere and another one is embryonic cell. The megameres, they again divide and form similar kind of cell, which are like megameres. But embryonic cell, they divide and form two different kinds of cells, which are called as mesomeres and micromeres. Okay, so micromeres, they again divide and form a rounded mass, which is called as morula. On the other hand, the megameres, they absorb all the yolk and become larger in size. That's why the yolk will gradually disappeared. Now these yolky megameres form nutritive envelope or outer embryonic membrane, which provide nourishment to other cell. But on the other hand, the mesomere, which are thick hard cuticularized and radially striated cells, now called as embryophore, and it form a thin basement membrane. Okay, so at the stage of morula, there are formation of different kinds of cells like megamers, micromeres, mesomeres with basement membrane. Okay, and the disappearance of the yolk. So this is the special or specific characteristic of the stage of morula. Okay, after this it will go to the another stage which is called as hexacanth and oncosphere. In stage of hexacanth and oncosphere, here you can see three pairs of chitinous hooks are formed. That's why this stage of morula is called as hexacanth, because of the three pair means six hooks are present. That's why it is called as hexacanth. And in this stage it also having a pair of large penetration gland. Now this whole structure of this morula, it is called as oncosphere. Okay, now in oncosphere stage it will also lose its outer cell which is chorionic membrane, and in this stage the cleavage will stop, means it will not further divide, and all the oncosphere they will stored in the uterus or in gravid proglottid, and increases in size because of the accommodation of more and more oncosphere. Now after the formation of oncosphere and the storage of oncosphere in uterus, the proglottid that termed as gravid proglottid, at this stage the gravid proglottid they detach from the strobila through the process which is called as apolysis, and these gravid proglottid in the group of 4 to 5 they pass out from the host body with its feces, and if such infected feces is eaten by the pig, then the oncosphere reaches to its stomach, and with the help of pepsin enzyme it loses or it dissolves its outer wall. As a result, free hexacanth embryo, it comes out and it goes to the small intestine, where its remaining membrane with the help of the alkaline juices are also lost. Now the hexacanth is activated by the bile salt. With the presence of bile salt, it is activated and makes its way to intestinal epithelium or bores the intestinal epithelium with the help of its three pairs of hooks. Okay, so and it reached to the submucosal blood or lymph vessel. At this stage the hooks are shed off because now they do not have any work, or there is no use of the hooks because they reach the submucosal blood. Now the blood will carry them, the hexacanth, from one place to another. That's why the hooks are shed off. And from the reaching the stomach to the submucosal blood, the hexacanth, it takes about 10 minutes. Then the submucosal vessel carry hexacanth to hepatic portal vein. From hepatic portal vein to it reaches liver, and liver to it reaches to atrial circulation, or it reaches to heart and enters the atrial circulation, and finally reaches to stripped muscles or voluntary muscles of tongue, shoulders, neck, thigh, heart, etc., where it settles down, and finally it converts itself into another stage which is called as bladder worm or cysticercus. So from the oncosphere to convert it itself in cysticercus stage, it takes about 10 weeks of time. Here you can see the whole life cycle of tinea solium from the formation of oncosphere to adult tinea. So let's start with oncosphere stage. The gravid proglottids in feces, it contains oncosphere stage. When such feces is eaten by the pig, then it goes to these oncosphere, goes to the stomach of the host, the secondary host, and with the help of pepsin enzyme, its outer shell wall is dissolved. Then the hexagon embryo, it comes out. It pass into small intestine, where its remaining membranes are also dissolved or lost due to the presence of alkaline juices. Now this hexagon activated by the bile salts and bores its way to intestinal wall with the help of its three pairs of hooks. Now finally it reaches to submucosal blood or lymph vessel, where it loses or it shed off its three pairs of hooks because now they do not have any use for it. That's why. From oncosphere to reach this submucosal blood or lymph vessel, it takes about 10 minutes. Then in submucosal blood, this hexagon goes to liver via hepatic portal vein. From liver, it reaches to heart. Then from heart, it reaches to stripped or voluntary muscles via atrial circulation. These voluntary muscles of tongue, shoulder, neck and thigh or heart, it again settle down there, and now it transforms it into the next stage, which is called as cysticercus or bladder worm. Now if such infected pork or measly pork is eaten by the man, then this cysticercus form goes into the intestine of man, where 7 to 8 weeks it converts into adult tinea solium. So in pig's body, it finally convert into cysticercus or bladder worm. If it do not get further its primitive host, then in that case in pig's body it leads to inactive mode of life and remain viable for several years, after which it dies and become calcified. But from cysticercus to convert into adult tapeworm, it should be ingested by the human host. Then its viable or its active mode of life will be continued. So the pork containing this cysticercus is called as measly pork. And you can imagine, in 1 kilogram of measly pork, it may contain about 500 or more cysticercus. Okay, so when such meat is eaten by the man, then the cysticercus becomes active and reach to intestine of the man, and its proscolex, it starts evagination and anchors the intestinal wall and suck the digested food of the host and begins to start or proliferate its proglottids from its neck region. Then later on, the bladder is detached and digested by the digestive juices of the host, and from cysticercus to it finally convert into adult tapeworm, and it takes about 7 to 8 weeks to convert from cysticercus to tapeworm, and finally it forms the gravid proglottids, and these gravid proglottids, they again detached from the strobila, and from the host body it goes outside through its feces. And if such infected feces is again eaten by the pig, then its life cycle is further goes on. So this is the whole life cycle of the tinea solium. This picture is showing all its stages which goes on in stomach of the pig, from oncosphere to the formation of cysticercus larva or bladder worm. This is the adult tinea solium structure, which finally formed inside the man intestine. Now let's see the disease caused by tinea solium. So the disease caused by tinea solium is commonly called as castodiasis. And the infection of adult tapeworm, which is called as tineasis. And while those suffering with cysticercus, the infection is called as cysticercosis. Okay, so let's start with symptoms of tineasis. So in case of tineasis, pain in the abdomen, regular pain in the abdomen, nausea with diarrhea. The patient will be anemic. Then its appetite will be increased. Then it will take more and more food and increase of eosinophil cells in the blood. Then in case of nervous system, nervous disorders like epilepsy is there. In case of cysticercosis disease, which is caused by the cysticerci, it is most dangerous than teniasis, because if the deposition of bladder worm in voluntary muscles of host like liver, heart, tongue, neck, and even more in delicate vital organs like eyes and brain, makes its removal very difficult. That's why it is very dangerous, that of teniasis. So the symptoms for cysticercosis is, if it occurs in brain, then it leads to necrosis, means death of the brain cells, and which leads to the memory loss of the patient. Then if the cysts are formed in brain, then the condition is called as neurocysticercosis, and the symptoms are like headache, blindness, convulsions, and epileptic seizures, and can be fatal. Infection of tapeworm can be treated by anti-helminth drugs like camoquine, carbon tetrachloride, quinacrine, antiphon, and dichlorophen, etc. Beside these, albendazole or praziquantel, these two drugs can be taken within 6 months, every 6 months by each healthy man, so that the infection of worms can be treated. Beside this, removal of scolex can be brought about by the surgery, but the removal of cysticerci from brain, eyes, and liver is extremely difficult. So for its prevention, avoid eating measly pork or partially cooked pork or meat. If meat is cooked, then it should be cooked at least in 145 degree Fahrenheit. On the other hand, feces of infected persons should be properly disposed of and destroyed. And lastly, preventing pigs having access to them and ingesting hexacanth embryos. So these all are the treatment or prevention from the any kind of worm infection. And finally, the prevention can be taken by the hygiene processes. So friends, this is all about the Tinea solium, with its external feature, its life cycle, disease caused by the Tinea solium, its diagnosis, treatment, and finally prevention. I hope this lecture will help you in your studies, as well as to prevent yourself from cysticercosis and teniasis. Thank you!